My dear friends of Christ and Him crucified, you may remember from Shakespeare the famous speech of Mark Antony over Caesar. He said, "I will show you sweet Caesar's wounds. Poor, poor dumb mouths, and bid them speak for me." Instead of showing you Caesar's wounds, I shall show you the wounds of Christ, who is both God and man, the only one who ever came to this earth to die and to conquer it. You and I came into the world to live. He came into the world to offer His life for us. And so He founded a new type of religion. All other religions, without exception, go from man to God, either by contemplation or by a kind of mortification and self-denial, the Eightfold Path of Buddha. But with our Blessed Lord, religion comes from God to man. We need help, in particular in redemption from sin. Now, what happened before the crucifixion is too long to tell except in symbolic language. I shall tell it to you in terms of sounds. Not often does one hear sounds like those which accompany the death of Christ. One, the smack of lips, when Judas threw his arms around the neck of our Blessed Lord and blistered His lips with a kiss. Then there was also the clanking of coins when Judas took back the 30 pieces of silver, sent them rolling over the temple floor, and said, "I have betrayed innocent blood." The crowing of a cock, as Peter boasted the night of the Last Supper, that though others would deny our Lord, he would not. And yet our Lord said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." The splashing of water, when Pilate, who knew that our Blessed Lord was innocent, called for a bowl of water, dipped his hands into the water, and holding them aloft, the water dripping from them like jewels in that morning sunlight, and said, See, I'm innocent of the blood of this man." And finally, there was one other sound, the thud of a hammer on nails. We go to Calvary, and we await the seven words that our Lord spoke from the cross, almost like seven funeral dirges. And with the beginning of the sound comes His last words. A question that is worth asking in our American culture is this: are you sick or are you a sinner? It is not very likely that you would call yourself a sinner in the modern age. Today people are sick. Are we going to a psychiatrist because we've committed adultery? Are we visiting a mental therapist because we're a homosexual? Are we being treated by a psychologist because we've been dishonest? It used to be that we Catholics were the only ones who believed in the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Now almost everyone in America believes he is immaculately conceived. There are no sinners. We are not responsible. We are not guilty. We may have an Oedipus complex, an Electra complex. Maybe our parents were poor, or we were raised on grade B milk, or there were not sufficient playgrounds in our neighborhood. But a sinner, that we could never be. Hence, in a trial of one of the presidents of the United States, it was generally admitted that he had made a mistake. There was no such thing as guilt. As a matter of fact, in the official declarations of the presidents of the United States, from George Washington up to the present day, the word sin was used only by one president, and that was Lincoln in 1863. In that proclamation, Lincoln said that we have offended divine providence and are guilty of sin. No other president ever used the word sin except Eisenhower. And then he did not use it as his own. He quoted this particular speech of Abraham Lincoln. It is therefore no wonder that a great psychiatrist like Carl Menninger has written a book, Whatever Became of Sin. He said the ministers of the priest no longer talk about it. So the lawyers and the jurists picked it up and it became a crime. Then they dropped it, and psychology picked it up, and it became a complex. Now, why is our blessed Lord on the cross at this particular moment? Why did he come to this earth? If you search the scriptures, you will find there was only one reason why our blessed Lord came: in order to do away with sin. He took our sins upon himself, as if he were guilty. All the prophecies about him, particularly Isaiah, speak of him as being made one with the transgressors, identifying himself with sinners. And how did he take sin upon himself? Well, because he's the new Adam. You see, we have received an inheritance, not of intensified evil, but a weakness from the first Adam. Now, the second Adam, Christ, came, and he starts a new humanity. In order to do that, he must blot out sin. So he becomes our stand-in, our representative. He takes our place. as if he were guilty of blasphemy. As if he were the sinner. Very much like, well, imagine a judge having before him his own son who committed murder. He killed a boy. Now, there's no doubt whatever of the son's guilt. Well, the father judge, bound to execute justice, sentences his son to death. That is justice. Then he says to the son, now I will take your place. I will die for you. That would be mercy. But that is not the complete picture. Suppose that at the moment the son was sentenced to death, the boy that the son had murdered walked in alive. Well, the son would say, how can you condemn me of murder? You see, I killed this boy. See, he's alive. I'm innocent. I should be free. That's precisely the condition that we are in. We were guilty of sin when our Lord rises from the dead, takes our guilt upon himself, washes it away. We can say, see, he's alive. He's not dead. I'm free. So that's why he came. Now that is why, when our Lord goes to Calvary and extends his hands to the executioners, and the rough nail is applied to the palm of his hand, from which the world's graces flow, at the very moment the blood is shed, what does he say? The high priestly prayer, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. It was addressed to the Heavenly Father. The plea was ignorance. If we knew what we were doing, for example, when we crucified the Son of God, we would never be saved. It's only the fact that we are ignorant of what we have done that brings us within the pale of the hearing of that cry. But the important point is that he spoke of forgiveness the moment he began shedding his blood. Because here we touch on a very vital word in Scripture. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Without the shedding of blood, not just good works, but the shedding of blood. Why is the shedding of blood required? Well, because sin is in the blood. It's in every alley and gateway of the body. It's in the body of the syphilitic. It's in the body of the diseased. It would almost seem, therefore, if we are to get rid of sin, we have to pour it out. But there's another reason. Life had to be forfeited for our sins. And no life was more precious than God who became man, because his blood was the blood of the God-man. And therefore he paid the infinite price. We were not bought with gold and silver, but with the precious blood of Christ. That is how our sins are forgiven. And that is why our blessed Lord prayed. At the moment that he poured out his blood for us sinners. Now, many of you have the faith. Now is the time to go to confession. Get rid of your sins. When the priest raises his hand in absolution over you, The blood of Christ is dripping from his fingers. We priests are hardly conscious of this great power. I think we would almost be shocked to death if we ever realized it. But that is how the sin is absolved. By this blood of Christ. So bring your sins to the confessional box. Or, if you have not been blessed with the fullness of faith, there's something else that can be done. Buy a book. And by a book, I mean the crucifix. Did you know that your life has been written? The crucifix is your autobiography. The parchment is skin. The pen, the nails. The ink is blood. There is not a single sin that we have ever committed that cannot be read in that book. Sins of pride, the head crowned with thorns. Sins of avarice and dishonesty. He had to have his hand riven with steel. All the times we wandered from grace and went away from the path and way of righteousness, he had to have his feet fastened to a cross. For all false loves, the pierced side, the sins of the eyes, blood in his eyes, flies buzzing about them. Sins of hearing, sins of taste, sins of lust, flesh hanging from him like purple rags. Every single sin is there. And if we got into the habit of looking at that crucifix every day and thinking of those words, Father, forgive, we would come to a deeper understanding of the blood of Christ. I have in my bedroom, just opposite my bed, a very large crucifix that's over 6 feet high. It's the first thing that I look at every morning. And the last thing that I look at every night. And in that way, I read my life. I do not need to wait for a biographer. It is already there. And one of the conditions of receiving the full pardon of our blessed Lord is that we pardon others. As he forgave our sins, we have to forgive the sins of others. One of the peak and most exalted descriptions of that I ever read was about a Russian bishop who not very long ago was sentenced to death by the communist authorities in Russia. And his last prayer for his communist executioners was this. He said, Heavenly Father, I offer up for the sins of these men and for my own sins, the death of your son. But I also forgive my executioners. As you forgive me. And so on Judgment Day, when these men stand before you, the angels will ask, what charge is brought against these men? There will be no one to charge them with guilt. They are already forgiven. Thomas More, in his death, said somewhat the same thing. There were a couple of fallen priests who came to see him. He said, I will ask the good Lord to forgive you. And then you will not be accused, but we will all meet very merrily in heaven. This then is the message of the first word. You are a sinner. Now you may have mental troubles and all that. That's for the business of a psychiatrist. Believe me, there are many people today who are being treated for mental troubles that are only the superficial manifestation of moral guilt in the human soul. And until they get rid of that, they will have all the psychic effects of guilt. One of the archbishops of France, the Archbishop of Paris some years ago, was preaching a sermon and he said, years ago, some boys came into Notre Dame Cathedral and they stood outside of a confessional box and they bet one another. Who is brave enough to go in and make a mock confession? And we will give 10 francs to anyone who does it. One boy said he would go in and make a mock confession. So he went in and made a mock confession. He was given a penance. Came out, he asked for the 10 francs and they said, well, you haven't said your penance. Must have received one. What is your penance? So he walked up to the communion rail. He knelt before a crucifix. And he raised his fist. And he said to our Lord on the cross, you died for me, but I don't give up. He couldn't finish it. And the archbishop concluded the sermon saying, I am that boy.